of the Disney Resorts Podcast. My name is Kenny Hayes, and I am joined alongside, as always, by the one, the only, Walt Ramirez.
Good evening, Ken. How are you today?
Well, I'm doing very good. I know I might sound a little nasally, got a little bit of a head cold. All is well. I promise everyone.
I'm glad to hear that.
Is it Thanksgiving or Thanksmas?
Yeah, I think it's Thanksmas. Yeah, I think so. I think it's Thanksmas. I think Santa Claus gobbled up Thanksgiving and now it's Thanksmas.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. So happy Thanksgiving, everyone. Thanksmas, whatever you celebrate. You know, we hope you enjoy it. This will be our last episode before the holiday. So, you know, Walter and I hope that everyone has a good time with friends and family this upcoming week. Absolutely. But we have a great show lined up for you today. Some news coming out of Walt Disney World. Moonlight Magic dates have been announced for 2024. We'll give you the information on that. Yeah. Woohoo. Walter's favorite. DVC talk is Walter's favorite. Guardians of the Galaxy. Some pretty big news. Walter's very happy with this news, and he's going to be bringing it to you shortly. New Year's Eve party. Alice in Wonderland at California Grill, located over at the Contemporary. Want to get a little bougie? This is the party for you. You want to stick around and listen to us about that. And we have much, much more. But before we begin, as always, if you're watching us over on YouTube, consider subscribing. Give this video a thumbs up. Of course, on the audio side, please give us a 5-star review. Why? You know why. Because you know you like us. So with that said, I will turn it over to Walter. What do you got for us tonight?
Well, since you brought it up, I'll start out with your favorite topic, DVC. The announcement of Moonlight Magic dates, one which is in December of this year at Animal Kingdom on the 13th. And then why don't you update us, Ken, on the dates for the other ones in 2024?
Yeah, so it recently came out from DVC, the Moonlight Magic dates for 2024. And then it looked like they also added a date in December of this year, 2023, for Animal Kingdom. So I'll give you those dates and parks right now. Animal Kingdom on December 13th of this year, 2023. Then in February 27th in 2024 and April 23rd. Over to Epcot, January 25th and March 1st. And then we are off to Hollywood Studios. Only one date, Walt. August 27th. Good old dog days of summer for Hollywood Studios. Yeah. And then Typhoon Lagoon coming in at June 4th and July 11th. And you may have not heard Magic Kingdom. Again, Magic Kingdom for the second year in a row has been snubbed from the Moonlight Magic list. Walter asked me before taping, you know, did they do Moonlight Magic at Magic Kingdom before? And they did pre-pandemic. And it just seems like, for whatever reason, Magic Kingdom has disappeared in the plague era of Moonlight Magic. So
I'm excited.
I don't know. Well, you know what? Well, let me think. I just thought about it. It actually just hit me. Is it because of all the after hours that they possibly want? You have after hours already, paid after hours, right?
Ah.
So, you know.
They don't want to tie up good old
Magic Kingdom for free.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only thing I could think of. What else could it be, Walt?
Yeah, I agree with you. I think I think it's definitely after hours at Magic Kingdom that it's probably not. Listen, Moonlight Magic's just one day though out of the year, so you can't tell me you can't squeeze one more day in there somewhere. You know, so I don't know. I've never been, obviously, to a Moonlight Magic because when I was a DVC member, it just never really fit into my schedule to go there around those particular times. But I know you've been to one. In your honest opinion, do you feel that is an event worthy of your membership in DVC?
Well, if you're buying DVC for Moonlight Magic,
No. That's not what I'm saying.
Let me purchase in a DVC so I could get Moonlight Magic. Number one, Moonlight Magic is not guaranteed. they could go like this tomorrow and those events never happen again. They're not in writing. They're not binding. There's nothing, a contract. They could come and go as they please. I will say, I think they, if you are a member and you are a direct member, it's not because it's for direct members. I think it's a pretty good product. I do. They have, and we'll probably talk about it later because they just did another holiday hard ticket party that wasn't so hot or jolly. It's not overly crowded and you can get on rides and you have special meet and greets and you have special food, which they have cut back since the pandemic. You don't feel overrun. Like my last one was in 2022, was in Animal Kingdom. And we had a good time. The only problem, though, is that a thunderstorm rolled in, so it kind of cut our night short. So good thing we didn't pay for it.
Right.
But if you want to get on rides, and like I know Epcot this past year, actually currently in 2023, they did a different fireworks show. So it's definitely worth it. If you're down there, because it's easier. So it's open. The availability is open to people who are staying there first. And then if it doesn't fill up, then if you're not on property, then you can put yourself into the waiting. So I have done it three times, twice at Animal Kingdom, once at Hollywood Studios. It's fun. It's a lot of fun. But like I said, the best part about it is you're not overwhelmed. The park is not overrun. Okay. You know, it's kind of like, you know, like Walt, they do the after hours or the extra magic, whatever they want to call it now, you know, for the deluxe, and you know how it's not overly run like that. That's basically crowd levels for a Moonlight Magic.
The extra cash grab. Listen, the extra cash grab. Yeah, I'm glad that you said that. I feel like DVC members, I think, get shortchanged in when it comes to that type of thing, because you've made a huge investment in being a DVC member, and I think they kind of owe it to you to give you an event. I mean, we're talking an event that's once a year in these parks. It's not like you're doing it every month, you know, and to do an event and make it like really a wow factor type of an event. You know, I can't comment on it because I've never been to one. But going off of what you're saying, I mean, it sounds like, you know, they put on a pretty decent show for people. But I still think that for what it is, it probably still could be a little bit better. Because I know you mentioned that there wasn't a lot of merchandise the last time you went, that you were looking for some special merch and you couldn't find anything at all. So, you know.
No, I was very shocked because pre-pandemic, they had exclusive merchandise in regards to not only just Moonlight Magic, but for that actual park. Mm-hmm. And there was nothing. There was nothing.
Yeah.
And there hasn't been anything because people have reported on it.
Right.
You get a popcorn bucket with a generic logo on it. That's it. That's all you're getting. So that's another that's disappointing. It's disappointing.
So on some good news, Guardians of the Galaxy Cosmic Rewind.
What's not disappointing?
Just won for outstanding attraction in 2024. They won the prestigious, which I didn't know was prestigious, but apparently it is, the THEA Award, which stands for Themed Entertainment Association. The award itself was based on this being the first reverse launch roller coaster at Disney World. And it's a what's known as an omnicoaster ride system, which, you know, moves you and angles you throughout the ride so that you're always fully immersed in what's going on. So that it was nice to see, because I feel that it's the best ride on property. I know that my niece Meadow was on there, and she also agrees with her uncle that this is the best ride on property. It is, in my opinion, and many other folks' opinion, the best ride on property. I think it's comparable to anyone who's been on the Harry Potter ride over in Universal. It's very comparable to that, if not slightly better. But it depends on what kind of theming you prefer. But it's good to see because in my opinion, this was a ride that possibly is the last ride we've seen where the Imagineers, I think, were actually allowed to do what they wanted to do and weren't constrained by budgetary issues. Because I think a lot of times, especially in recent times, there's probably people in Imagineering that have great ideas for rides that probably never get to see a green light on any of these rides because, mm-hmm. you know, the people up at the top don't want to spend the money. And I think this ride really shows you what Imagineering is capable of putting together when you take off the constraints of, you know, budgets and what other every other issue that corporate seems to be putting on them. And it's good to see. I'm sure they're very happy. I'm sure they're thrilled that they won this award. And it's well deserved in my opinion. And I think it's one of the rides that I think is gonna last the test of time. I think this ride will be there for a very, very long time and people will enjoy it. Even when this movie is, you know, historically not, you know, relevant anymore, I think people will it'll still be there and people will still enjoy it. So, and at some point in the future, we will get you on this ride. If I have to drug you and videotape it with you drooling out of the side of your mouth and not being, you know,
people would probably pay for that.
Yes. We'll show you the video back and say, see, Kenny, you did ride it. Even though you don't remember it.
Look, there he goes. It's almost like, what was that movie when we were growing up? When our boss, he's dead and they drag him around everywhere and they don't.
Weekend at Bernie's?
Yeah, Weekend at Bernie's. Just sitting there like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you remember it? Yeah. Absolutely not. And I was going to ask you, well, since this won this prestigious award, and since mm-hmm. it's your favorite ride, and it's most people's favorite ride on property now, especially if you're an adrenaline junkie, I was like, do I have to go on it now because it won an award? No.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, you do. You have to. You're required to go on.
Walter's like, yes, you absolutely have to go on now.
But listen, this is, again, you know, not to, you know, dwell on it, but this ride is not what I would call an adrenaline junkie ride because –
yeah,
it's really not that intense. In comparison to other rides in Disney World, there are things that are more intense. Like I think mm-hmm. Rock and Roller Coaster is much more intense because you're going upside down. You know, you can even make an argument for Tower of Terror because it's dropping you, you know, multiple floors and shooting you back up again and dropping you again. So this isn't that type of a ride. I actually think that for people that are afraid of roller coasters, I would say this is actually a good place to start because you're really not, you know, other than
I started on Barnstormer.
Yeah. Well, Big Thunder Mountain too, you know, is a pretty good place to start. You know, any of those type of rides, but this ride, definitely, I would eventually at some point, I'd like to see you get on this ride because I'm telling you, you're going to get off and you're going to say, you know what? You're absolutely right. And I missed out all this time. I could have been enjoying it. So, but you
it's
know,
funny because you give me this, dream. We could dream. You tell me that it's not so bad. It's not so bad. And then I talk to other people who have similar like me and they're like, I will never go on it again. I will never go on it again. So I'm like, I think Walter's trying to talk me on to getting on this.
Yeah. Well,
and then the rest of my day and I have vertigo. Yeah, so I don't want to be shot the rest of the day.
Those people have built in fears for things and they probably shouldn't go on there anyway. But in terms of like if you were to say to me, hey, Walter, this is going to be a ride that's going to drop you like 200 feet and you're going to be pinned in your seat. I'd say, yeah, definitely not enjoyable. But this is so smooth. And, you know, even your daughter agrees. She's, you know, this is one of those rides where it doesn't jar you around. You know, the even the tracking system, which I guess is one of the reasons why they won the award, is so innovative because it doesn't, it's so smooth. It just glides you through the ride. You don't even feel like you're on a track. If you've ever been on, like, you've been on Big Thunder Mountain, it's very noisy.
Oh, yeah. I like it.
You know, clanky and although, and it's bumpy. And even though it's technically supposed to be that way because you're in a mine car, it doesn't, this is completely different. So, but anyway, so let's move on to number three here on the news cycle here. Something that you pointed out to me last night, which I was initially surprised at. And then when I kind of started peeling back the layers of the onion, I said, okay, kind of makes sense. Alice in Wonderland inspired New Year's Eve party over at California Grill this year, was just announced by Disney. And this is a New Year's Eve party that comes with a pretty hefty price tag of $799 per person. Now the event starts at 7:30 p.m. The problem I have with this event, surprisingly, which might surprise you, is not really the price point, because most New Year's Eve events are overpriced regardless of wherever you go, whether you go to your local, a local restaurant to spend New Year's Eve, or
they are,
you know, whatever, wherever you venture out on New Year's Eve, you're going to get walloped for a hefty price tag. So this one, because you are going to have characters throughout the evening, and you're going to have carving stations and exquisitely good food, at California Grill, and assuming all you can drink, for $7.99, although it is beyond my budget that I would spend for a New Year's Eve party, I don't think it's outrageously bad. My issue when I first saw this was what time they tell you to leave. So the party ends at 12:30.
That's crazy.
This is New Year's Eve.
New Year's Rockin' Eve is still going, man.
Exactly. I mean, you're still having a good time, and they're telling you, okay, get out. You know, and you know, I don't, you know, you've been to California Grill like I have. That's not an easy exit. You got to get on that elevator, and you can't fit a lot of people on the elevator. So you're going to be out waiting for that elevator for probably a good half hour. So, you know, up and down, up and down. So it's just, to me, it's just one of those things where, again, Disney kind of misses the boat on this, because this is an $800 event, and you're basically telling people on New Year's Eve, okay, you know, 12:30, go home. You know, I mean, what's your thoughts on this, Ken?
Be honest with you, I feel the same way as you. I like the idea. I wish I could actually try the event, and I am with you. With the fact of the $800 doesn't bother me. Like you said, you could go to a lot of places and you're going to spend $300, $400, $500 for, you know, all you care to, we'll go Disney words, all you care to enjoy. And there's a lot of places that it's not all you care to enjoy, and you're still spending hundreds of dollars, you know, but you're going to get alcohol, food, and, you know, reading this, they got some bougie food there. So there's stuff there that I can't even pronounce. So it is definitely pinky up kind of place, kind of night going on. But, and then you got the characters from Alice in Wonderland, which you don't, well, you do see some of them. You had the Mad Hatter and Alice here. Great views. I'm assuming, they're probably not going to have a fireworks show, a special fireworks show, because guess what? 12:30, get out. You know, and it's funny because when you sit there and right before the hours, it says, oh, we'll have a champagne toast at midnight. And then guess what? Hit the road. That's Bye. What it is. I would have, yeah, goodbye. Mickey pat you on the way out. Thank you very much. Or Alice or the Mad Hatter going nuts. But I would have rather seen. Now, people will say, Ken, well, it's Disney. You know, it's not, you know, you're not somewhere else. But guess what? I understand it's Disney, but it's not like you're trucking your kids there. This is going to be an adult party, right? So if you're going to have an adult party, let's do adult things. 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning it should be. It should at least be 1:30. Start the party at 8:30, go to 1:30.
I agree.
Right? It's the 12:30. It's crazy.
It's Listen, crazy.
Love
it's...
California Grill. I'm not fond of the why can't I think of the name of it? They shrunk the menu, the prefix menu.
Prefix menu.
Since COVID, they've had the prefix menu, which I'm not a fan of, but love the restaurant. Love the decor. There's the view is outstanding. If you want to talk about a view on property, it's arguably the best. So it you hit, you know, like five star and everything, besides the fact you're kicking people out right after the champagne toast.
Yep.
You know, and that's, you know, listen, New Year's Rockin' Eve is still going on ABC at 12:30. So should Disney.
Yeah, well, it's they own it. You know, they own WABC. They own ABC.
Exactly, they own it. They should actually have a segment where they go live to California Grill.
There you go. That would be
people get booze.
Now you're thinking. Yeah,
we should just go to work for them.
Yeah, well, that listen, good ideas go to die at Disney. So that's that doesn't happen. I agree with you on that. I think I don't know the scheduling of it, but I would assume that Magic Kingdom is going to have its fireworks that night at some point, and you probably will get a fireworks view.
Probably show during it.
Yeah, during that party. Now it might be at 11 or 11:30. I don't know what time the park's open till that night, but I assume going by the Grandpa Disney hours of 12:30 party time that Magic Kingdom might be closing at 10 that night. I mean, who knows? This is again missing the boat, you know, and it seems like they missed the boat a lot lately. I don't know if you've been noticing that, but it seems like they missed the boat a lot. And that kind of segues us into an event that they just had, which you brought up earlier, which was Jollywood Nights over at over at Hollywood Studios. And
Hollywood Studios.
This is probably, you might call it the Jollywood Nights disaster, because it just seemed like everyone that went there had nothing good to say about the event. An event that, by the way, comes with a $179 price tag on it, just like every other, extra hours events that they have there. Who comes up with that number, too, by the way? That always kind of bugged me. Like, why 179? Like, why don't we just add another dollar on and make it 180? Like, does the 179 really, when I look at it and go, oh, wow, what a great deal this is, 179. I saved a dollar. I mean, this pricing is just bizarre to me. But the event itself, now let's just start at the beginning with this thing. Okay, first of all, it's the first night of this party.
Yep.
So what do you think happens the first night? All the vloggers have to go because everybody has to be there on the first night so they can be relevant and be, you know, posting so that they can get all their likes and all their viewers can enjoy this stuff. Okay, great. But you can't sit there then and turn around and complain about how crowded it is because you've added to the problem. So you've added to the problem by going to this event on the first night that it's available. So, but that aside, this is a 4-hour event, right? So I've been to Extra Magic Hours events. We talked about this on a previous episode where I went to the one at Hollywood Studios, which was because I was staying at a deluxe resort. It's different, obviously, because it's not an after hours party and it's severely limited because it's only for guests that are staying at deluxe resorts. But I'm curious, I don't know about you, but I'm curious to find out how many tickets do they actually sell for these events? And is there a limit to the tickets?
I don't know. And that's a good question, Walt, because I was watching a lot of the vlogs so far. And like you said, they're very far and few in between the people who have said nice things about Jollywood Nights. And you know what? I'm very disappointed because I was very excited. And all I keep playing in my head You remember the song, "Oh, Those Hollywood Nights," right?
Yes.
So all I keep playing in my head is, "Oh, Those Jollywood Nights," right? And they disappointed me because everyone's trashing it. They're trashing Jollywood Nights.
Yes.
And they do. So now, granted, you have seen it. I have not. But from what you have told me and everybody else I know who's experienced it, Mickey's Very Merry is done very well and goes off without a hitch. So you know what to do. You know how to do a hard-ticketed event. And Jollywood Nights tanked. Tanked. And Walt, there's a part of me that wants to love it. I love the logo. I love how they have the gingerbread, all the displays they had. Hollywood Studios is also my favorite place to visit during Christmas because of the era. I love that decor. I love that they play the traditional holiday music. It's one of my favorite parks anyway, but at the holidays, it's the best on property in my opinion. And to hear these people everyone just relax that Walter and I are discussing just what we have seen and heard from, you know, all these people who experienced it. Like you had dinner. There was a dinner at the Brown Derby, which I guess you had to go and line up in line to get it, like almost like a virtual queue, which I heard that turned into a disaster. And then listening to other media outlets, I guess they had a media event prior to this. And they were explaining how, like, inside the Brown Derby, how it was going to be so beautifully decorated for the holidays. They had, like, one area of garland lit up in front of the guy who was playing the piano, and that was it.
Yeah.
This
looked like it was
hearing that. It's so disappointing.
It looked like it was an event that was just thrown together. And obviously, I know it wasn't, but it was like it was thrown together like the day before. Like, we're going to just whip something up really quick, and this is what we're going to. You had to realize how many tickets you sold. You had to realize how long these lines were going to be for these things. And what always gets me is I don't understand why, when you have special offerings for these events, like such as like cookies or a beverage or some kind of a, you know, special popcorn tin, whatever it is, whatever special thing you might have for these events, why do you only have it in like select locations? It should be available pretty much like everywhere so that you eliminate the line situation. So like you could like, why do I have to line up to get something and spend a half an hour online? Just have it available everywhere. You have multiple carts available throughout this park during the day to sell popcorn and soda. You have no problem with that. You have, no matter where I go in the park, there's somebody selling Powerade and water all day long. Have these carts instead, you know, retrofit them so that now your whatever the specialty is for that evening, you have it available throughout the park so that no one's wasting time on these lines. They had two shows evidently that were really good, but each show could take up an hour of your night. Mm-hmm. So now it's a 4-hour event. There goes two hours. And then if you want to ride some rides, you know, the lines weren't, from what I understand, weren't like extraordinarily long, but they were still, you know, a decent amount of time that you spent online. You're going to shortchange yourself. You're going to rush around. The problem with these events that I have is that you rush around and you don't enjoy the night. You almost like feel like it's like you have to, it's the, you know, fear of missing out, the FOMO. You know what I mean? So you have to like run around and hit everything that everyone is talking about because you don't want to miss out on something. And the events are too short. And again, this is kind of like the New Year's Eve party where it's a shakedown where give me your money, hurry up and get out. All right. Yep. And this is what it is. It's what it's turned into. And this isn't, if you're going to have an event at a park, especially like this type of event, which is it's not even extra magic. It's a holiday event. Then make it worth your while by making it longer so that the person who's coming in and trying to enjoy this doesn't have to feel shortchanged. And there's no excuse why they can't shut the park down. I've seen Magic Kingdom shut down at 6 o'clock on nights of special events. There's no reason why you can't have a park closed down a little bit earlier, even if it's an hour earlier. It makes a big difference. And then you allow these people to go in prior to and maybe enjoy a little bit of it as the regular day guests filter out, the way they do with other events. And I'm not, perhaps that's what they do. I'm not, I might be speaking out of turn here because maybe they do that for this, but I think 4 hours is just too short of a time frame for that amount of money that you're spending. You mentioned something about the Brown Derby. If I were going to an event like this, I would not be focused on a sit down meal because
me either.
To me, your wait, like that's a whole hour out of your night at least. So you're wasting the, if I'm paying $179, I'm there to enjoy the rides, enjoy the park, maybe take in some special entertainment, whatever it is, maybe, you know, some finger foods. But to then say, oh, I'm going to sit down at a restaurant for an hour, I you know, to me, I wouldn't do that. I would rather have sort of like a little buffet area somewhere where you can walk around and maybe grab some things. But, you know, it's disgusting because it really, they just stick their hand in your pocket and they just don't care anymore about the quality of what they're putting out. And it's shameful, you know, and I saw a lot of people, a lot of vloggers that were outraged by this, and people that normally don't react in a negative way reacted quite negatively to it. And, you know, that's when you know you're losing people, when you start losing people that normally don't whine and complain, because you and I have had criticisms in the past from people because they say, oh, we're too negative and we harp on the negative. There's people out there that don't harp on the negative and we had nothing nice to say about this event. So Disney has to kind of pull back and say, hey, we got to get better. We've got to get better. But I, again, and we talked about this and we've been talking about this for weeks now and episodes over and over again. People will still buy the tickets and go to these events. So they complain and they whine and they say, oh, I had a bad time. And then the next event rolls out and boom, they're there on their first day. And it's so it's like, listen, I don't want to stop going. If you want Disney to get better, if you want them to improve, you need to stop going so that they eventually will say, wow, we've got to wake up here and we've got to make some changes. So
my last comments, Walt, in regards to the Jollywood Massacre. Oh, I'm sorry. Jollywood Nightmare. No, wait a minute. No, I was wrong again. Jollywood Nights. Oh, those Jollywood Nights. Damn you, Disney World. You got that stuck in my head. You know, you have long lines, virtual queue. That's true. Hey, listen, you guys call me. I'll fly down. I'll fill in for Jollywood. I will. And I haven't sung on a show in a while, so it's good. I got it out of my system. But, you know, people were complaining they couldn't get into Brown Derby with the lounge, etc. Then the lines were extremely long because the other place to eat was ABC Commissary. The line was all the way out. You know, people are waiting in line 45 minutes to get in. I mean, everything I saw, and like you said, people that nearly never talk smack about Disney was just, it was an onslaught. And it actually hurts me. Because like when this event came out in the summer and they posted about it, I was like, wow, this is really cool. I hope it's good because I would want to do this. Like the park, love the holidays at Hollywood Studios. It just has a nice jingle to it. Like I was like, man, this is really cool. They really come up with something nice here. The only thing I can hope for is that they learn from this very quickly and they do whatever they have to do to not have this issue again. But in closing, you said something in the beginning of this topic. How many tickets are you people selling? How many tickets are you selling? Because I watched those videos and that place was packed. So, you know, are they just selling to see how many people are going to sell the ticket? And hey, whatever we sell is the people that are going to come in unless we hit capacity for park capacity. Or should it be a true hard ticket? People might disagree with me. Walt, you might disagree with me. I would rather pay $200 or $250 and know that there's going to be a very limited amount of people, you know, just down to several thousand, where the park is not overrun. Everybody can enjoy it. All aspects, from the food to the entertainment to the characters, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And you actually get your money's worth. Because that was a travesty, what I watched at $179.99, what you did to these people. So,
yeah, I agree with you. and get out. I agree with you. I'm not really the price point. Obviously, the price point reaches a limit where it doesn't make sense. But I agree with you as far as if it were a little bit more and you had less, you know, you sold fewer tickets so that you could move around a little bit better, or you made it where you walked away saying, and you've brought this up before a long time ago, where you always say you don't mind so much what you pay for as long as you feel like you got your money's worth.
Exactly.
And that doesn't happen ever anymore at Disney, unfortunately.
Nope.
Those days, I think, unfortunately, are gone, because right now all they care about is what can they get out of you? Where is the tipping point where people will stop buying tickets and they keep pushing the envelope and people still go? But I agree with you. I think I'll just as an example, I was many years ago, my wife and I went to Mickey's Not So Scary Halloween Party at Magic Kingdom.
Okay.
And we enjoyed it, but we didn't feel it was worth it because we just felt like where you got candy, you had to wait online. There were a lot of limited places. The parade, it was well worth it, and seeing the Headless Horseman and all that, no problem. I had no issue with that. Where I had an issue was the amount of people that were there, because in that spoke area where, you know, in front of the castle, I've never experienced in all my years of going to Disney feeling uncomfortable and claustrophobic the way I did that night, because I've been to concerts before. I've been to sporting events before where, you know, football games where you've had 70, 80,000 people at a football game. There were so many people trying to exit into that area at the end of that party that you got to a point where you were like, you were sandwiched in between so many people, you could not move, and it was scary. And I said to myself when I left, I'm like, how many tickets did they sell for this event? There were more people there that night than I think were there during the day, because you never get that feeling during the day
unless it's like Christmas Day or something.
Yeah, when they supposedly claim they're at capacity. I've never had that experience before in my life. And it made me question, like, how many tickets are they really selling? And are they just being greedy and shaking you down? And we're going back like probably almost 10 years now.
Yeah.
So that was then. Now I can't even imagine what they would attempt to do in terms of how many tickets they sell. But these events,
they sold a lot for Jollywood, I tell you that.
Yeah. I mean, listen, if you took the vloggers and all these people out of the picture, I would just be curious to see how many tickets they would sell. Because you have people that have turned Disney World into a business, and good for them. But don't complain and whine about crowds and quality, because really, if you really look at it realistically, and I know this is going to be a very unpopular opinion, the reason that Disney doesn't feel like they have to make changes is because they know that these people are going to show up. They're going to show up with their cameras and their iPhones, and they're going to show up no matter what. You could be like, Mickey Robs a Bank Day, and it's like they're going to show up. you know, so it doesn't matter what event they do. They're going to show up, and Disney knows that. So they know that they already have a built-in customer base that's going to show up no matter what. Now, granted, you know, these people are annual pass holders, so that's already a fixed amount of sales that you've made, because they're all annual pass holders. You know, that's where really what it comes down to. And when that is that ever going to change? Probably not in the world that we live in today, where, you know, everything is social media related and based. That's probably never going to change. So Disney knows that. And it bleeds over into other things. It bleeds over into accommodations and hotels. You know, one of the things that you and I, you know, I know that DVC is a big topic and a favorite topic of yours. And we just, well, I just watched something about, the, one of the rooms over at the Riviera. Okay. So there's a tower at the Riviera, that I'm still trying to figure out, like, who constructed this tower. Was it
the tower studio? Yes.
Yeah. The tower studios. Was it a troll? Was it a dwarf? I don't know who like designed that part of the building. But I mean, the rooms are outrageously tiny. I had a kind of an inkling of this because I had heard of it on previous podcasts. But when I watched this particular podcast, and they actually gave a review of the room and the cost of the room, it floored me. I could not believe the lack of service that you get in this room. This is a DVC resort, and it's one of the, you know, it's a brand new resort. It's a upper, quote unquote, upper echelon resort, you know, similarly to like a Grand Floridian or a Polynesian in that realm of room. And they don't even, there's no bed in the room. It's a Murphy bed.
That's it.
The room is, I think, I don't remember exactly the square footage, but it's very tiny. It's like the size of a dorm room.
It's I think it's two and change. It's only like two and change.
Yeah. That's what I thought. I didn't want to misquote it, but I was like, wow, 200 square. I mean, that's like my living room is bigger than that room. So,
and Walt, remember, you sent me the video and I watched it. Think about it. The bathroom is like literally the same size as your living quarters, just about.
Yeah. Yeah, I it floored me. And then my favorite part of that video was when they said that they actually make you make your own bed. Like you have to
give you in the go bags, get your linen closet.
Yeah, and make your own bed every night. There's no turndown service. And then they wanted and then my favorite part was the coffee maker and a toaster, and there's no outlet for both. There's only one outlet. So they have to actually plug in the toaster across the room on the other side of the room on the floor, because there was only one outlet for a coffee maker and or a toaster. You couldn't make your coffee and toast your toast at the same time.
Honey, can you get my toast off the floor? Thank you.
I mean, that's something that I would expect maybe the All-Stars, but at the Riviera, what are they thinking? And I here's the thing that floors me too about this. In this day and age that we live in this world that we live in of social media, this room should be killed every day by these vloggers. But somehow this is averted criticism by people. Why? Because they don't want to get – because they don't want Disney to get angry at them and shut them out and say, nope, you can't come. If you don't say nice things about our resort, you're not going to get a press credential. Is that the reason why? Because this is laughable, this product.
And the funny thing is, well, not too many people talk about it. I remember it was talked about right at the opening and right before and right after the opening of Riviera. Unfortunately, it opened in December. The plague hit in March. It was only open a few months before we had to shutter it down. And you really never heard of it again. You know, and bragged about, well, it's for a couple. But like they said, they laid everything out, took pictures. Now, granted, it could have been staged, but look, there's only so much room. Even a studio for me is someone who generally gets a one bedroom, even if it's just Beth or I, even when I get a normal standard side studio, sometimes I'm like, yeah, man. Granted, you're not in the room all day, but like, you're like, I want that room. Like, I would go nuts in that room. And when you look at the point value as someone for DVC, I'll just go get a regular studio. Like, at certain times of the year, it's not anything to brag about. And like you said, it's, you know, I don't know.
I think the price point too is the most insulting.
Oh, and the price point, like, what was it, $500 or $600 a night? No way.
It's $500 a night. I mean, that is outrageous. Listen, people who are fans of DVC are going to come back to me and say, well, you know, Walter, you don't have to stay there if you don't want to. Or, you know, well, that's true. But if you're going to offer that room, offer it at a reasonable rate. Because no one's going to stay in that room. If you're going to charge me $500 a night, I can have a room, a studio at Beach Club or Yacht Club for that price. A normal room. Why would I stay in a broom closet for $500 a night when realistically that room should be no more than $150? Okay. And the reason they don't charge that is because
again, for what they're giving you.
Yeah, they're protecting their rack rates. They want to protect their statistics and their rack rates at that hotel. They don't want to bring it down. So they're going to charge you a ridiculous price for a room that's the size of, you know, a cruise ship room. And it's just absurd. I don't understand why more people haven't talked about this. And it just seems like they just have given Disney and DVC a pass. I mean, there are so many people out there that have these, you know, these DVC vlogs and you know, come across with this, you know, higher than thou opinions on these things, as if like they've invented, you know, hotel rooms and room, you know, and DVC. And it's like, you know, be honest. If you're going to pitch a product, be honest to people. Say, hey, listen, this is crap, and that's what it is. And I have, you know, but again, everybody,
be honest.
Yeah, everybody is tiptoeing through the tulips on this because they don't want Mr. Iger to come down on them and say, "Give us back your
press credentials,
because that's what they threaten everybody with, or you know, you're not going to get access to, you know, the newest Disney resort that opens up so that you can vlog about it for, you know, relentlessly for an hour and a half. I saw this and I was super disappointed. The same review also gave another review of the Contemporary, and those rooms at the Contemporary were equally as ridiculous. A little bit larger, but still the refurb over there was
with the Incredibles layover.
It was Incredibles layover, and it was so tacky. It was the person reviewed it was an Edna Mode room. And you could have done it.
Oh, yes, the club level.
The club level, yeah. And that's a club level room. Again, here we go. It's club level room. You're expecting, you know, top of the line. And you're getting an Edna Mode decor that was comparable in tackiness to, say, the pirate ship room at Caribbean Beach that didn't no longer exist. But it was just... It was just a very tacky room. And so... Since we've been just beating DVC over the head now for the last 10 minutes, let's keep going. Let's keep going and continue to beat them up. And we're going to talk about Ken's favorite place, the Boardwalk. So Boardwalk just had a refurb. Mm-hmm. Now, Ken and I have a little bit of a disagreement on this. Ken actually likes the current refurb. I'm not a big fan of the refurb. But I'll let you go first and talk about some of the things that you – you know, like about the Boardwalk refurb.
So recently, pictures have now come out, as we all know, and Walter and I have reported on earlier in the year, that the Boardwalk Inn, which is the cash side, was under refurbishment. We posted pictures, we talked about it, and we'll put a link in the notes in the show notes so you can see our prior video in regards to that. So, picture just recently serviced of a deluxe studio that is refurbished on the villa side, which is DVC. basically the same, they use the same exact decor from the inside over in the Villa side. Now, if you remember in the past, the inside decor was greatly different from the Villa side. Mm-hmm. Now, they streamlined it. They put the Murphy bed in. They have a picture on the Murphy bed before you pull it down. Of course, there's one inside as well. They have like the Victorian kind of looking pictures on the wall, kind of like what you would see in next to the bed in Grand Floridian. Mm-hmm. So what people are saying in the articles that I wrote that people are, wow, I'm really struggling through this one. Well, let's start over, strike that, reverse that. So what people are talking about is that they're losing its theming. And you keep hearing this over and over and over again, is that if you take a few of these objects off the wall and I blindfolded you, you would not know you were in a forget a DVC resort. You would forget that you're not even in a Disney resort.
Correct.
I agree with that. However, if you ask me personally, I like the way it looks. So like, I know I'm walking that line of trying to walk both, but I'm just giving you my honest answer and review of what I've seen so far. I like the colors. I like the plaid headboard. I like the pictures on the wall. I like that and Walter's going to be very happy. No carpet. Well, actually they do. They do have a little mm-hmm. throw rug in front of the Murphy bed, but where I agree with Walter is that the theming is lost. You know, when you even the older looking Boardwalk Villas that I sat here and said, man, they need a refurb. You knew you were in a Boardwalk Villa, and now you don't. If I take those pictures off the wall, now what I did tell Walter is that I see the way they are going. I'm a Jersey Shore guy, like Cape May. Go to Cape May a lot. Cape May is a Victorian shore town. Oldest shore town in the country, by the way. And I think that's what they're trying to go with the decor there. Instead of like the more of like the boardwalk look, they're going for the shore Victorian look. That's what I think they're trying to grab there. And so far, people don't like it. Now we'll see once it's completed, and people really start going in. But like you said, I while I like it, I think they missed the mark.
Well, you're the one who basically stays there a lot more than I've ever stayed there, and this is your resort, so I have to respect your opinion on that because you would know. You frequented it, and this is kind of your favorite resort. The Disney theming, I think one of the things that you've always harped on a long time ago was that you felt like there's a lack of theming, especially Disney theming, in a lot of these resorts. And it seems like the DVC resorts, they've basically expunged all of the Disney theming from it. Like you said, you wouldn't even know if I blindfolded you and put you in the room, you wouldn't even know that you were in a Disney resort. The artwork on the walls doesn't, tell you anything about, Walt Disney World. From a refurb standpoint, I guess you're right. You did mention to me the last time you stayed there years ago that you felt like the rooms were pretty run down.
They were.
And that they need it. Yeah. So that's a good thing, at least.
Yes.
And there are some positive improvements where, like you said, they got rid of the carpeting and they made some minor adjustments. But it seems like, don't you think like this Murphy bed thing is a little bit overblown because it seems like they're putting it like everywhere?
Well, fortunately, since they're my points. Oh, wait a minute. I'm married. They're our points. Beth and I don't have to sleep on one of those. Yeah, now I'm in trouble now. However, so when Meadow goes and she comes with her boyfriend, yeah. And she goes, if we stay in a one bedroom, they use that. Now she has told me that it's much more comfortable than the pullout of the couch. In the old days you pulled the couch and it came out of the couch. So you don't have the bar in the back anymore. She said, well, while it is more comfortable than that. So I will give it that. But these people like fall in love with the Murphy bed, and I'm like, okay. But like even the one underneath the TV, you're only putting a child on that. Most adults are not going on that.
Yeah, you can't fit an adult.
I'm not going on that. No.
Yeah, no.
And people will disagree, and whatever, that you do you, but you know, that's more meant for kids.
Yeah, I mean, I guess they're trying to squeeze.
Yeah, you're getting five.
You know, another five in there. But it just seems like the decor in pretty much every hotel room now in Disney involves a Murphy bed or some kind of a pull down to try to squeeze, you know, another person into the room. So I guess they're trying to give you some value back, I guess, to some of the money that they've taken out of your pocket before you got there.
No, I agree. I agree with you.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so we're gonna wrap up tonight's show, but just to give you a brief glimpse into the future show, we have a topic that we didn't get a chance to talk about today that I wanted to discuss, which is the announcement in Disney's recent earnings report about some of the investments that they're making over the next several years. But unfortunately, it seems like the people who frequent Florida aren't going to be getting much of a benefit from those investments. So we're going to be talking about that on an upcoming show, possibly our next show. Just wanted to say to everybody, wishing everybody a happy Thanksgiving as we did when we let off the show, and hope that everyone enjoys the holiday, and we will see you again real soon, hopefully.
Yep. Good show as always, Walt. Thank you very much.
Have a good one, Ken.
And yep, you too. And to reiterate just what Walt said, I just want to wish everyone a happy and healthy Thanksgiving. Enjoy your time with your friends and loved ones, and we will see you back again real soon with another edition of the Disney Resorts Podcast. For Walt Ramirez, I'm Kenny Hayes. Take care, everybody.